let's stick right here. This is the moment. Come on, let's sing, let's sing, let's sing.
Thank you.
We know right now the enemy doesn't know what's happening. We should still be mourning. But our praise to you will get us through. So for these next few moments, Lord, may these words inspire us to continue to move forward despite what we are leaving behind. Because we do ask these things in the name of Jesus, our Savior, our friend, and the only one that deserves this highest praise. Hallelujah. Because we ask these things in the name of Jesus. Amen. I almost wish that it was just time for the benediction.
Oh, yes.
This is one of those days where when we just worship, it just seems to fill us up.
Yes.
And you know what? There are times where when we are going through things, whether it's illness, whether it's sickness, whether it's the challenges of life, I want to encourage you to praise God mostly more in those moments. Because whenever we praise God, it has a way of putting the things that we go through into perspective. Despite the deaths, despite the sicknesses, despite the broken families, despite the young people that may not be here today, He is still wonderful. And I also want to say this to you, church. At some point in all of our lives, we will have to get to a place where we lose consciousness of what other people may say when we stand and we raise our hands. Sometimes our worship doesn't come all the way out of us because we're concerned that if we put our hands up, if we yell out, if we scream to God, that somehow that is a form of unholiness. But I might beg to differ. Whatever your posture is, and not everybody will stand, and not everybody will scream, and not everyone will cry, but every single one of us in this building has our own way of worshiping God, and we ought not stifle it, whatever that is, because of the person beside us. And so I want to say thank you. I haven't met him yet, but your playing is pretty nice. I appreciate that. I appreciate that. Appreciate the band. I saw you playing a little bit higher up on the bass today. I don't know what all that means musically, but it did feel good. Now is the time. That is the title of the message today. The portion of our mission statement that I would like to tackle today is the importance of living by faith. And thank you, Artie. You did a fabulous job this morning leading the praise team. I want to start here because today's message is more directed to our young people, our children. But there are some principles that will be found there that will apply to all of us, I believe. One of the things that I have heard for years now is that the church or the children of today, they will become the church of tomorrow. Many of us have said that. Many of us have internalized that. But maybe I would argue today that the children are not the church of tomorrow, they are the church of right now.
Amen.
Now I hear you saying amen, and I don't know if amen is because you're still in the moment of the music or if you actually believe what I've just said. Because if you did, if we did, we would give them more opportunities to grow, to stretch their wings, and to fly, even if it wasn't at the level to which we might say that it should be. Are you with me so far, church? It's important that we instill in our children right now that they are the church of right now so that they will begin to take ownership of what happens in these pews. It's not about tithing later on when you get that first big job. It's about the stewardship now. It's not about when I finish getting my master guide training, then I will be able to do what I need to do. It's really about right now and not later. Because the truth is that the longer that we take to instill in our young people that they have the ability to make a difference right now, they will get older, they will become more mature, and they will leave because we will have never really their full potential based on what God has in mind for their lives. Amen, Pastor Anderson. Now that might even mean that in the context of what I'm talking about, it might mean that you hear Pastor Anderson preaching less if the children are equipped and ready to go. That would be fine. It might even mean that there would be months where maybe the praise team that we've enjoyed today wouldn't sing because the children that are the church of today should serve today. Now, I don't want anybody to go to our dean and after the sermon is finished and say, see, I told you so. I'm only making that as an example, but that principle sweeps across the church because the children are not the church of tomorrow. They are the church of right now. Now is the time, not later, not next week, not 2 months from now, not on their 14th birthday, not on their 21st graduation. The children are the church of the right now. And I have proof. I do have proof because I always like to start the plane on a scripture. And if you wouldn't mind, I'd love if you would be able to turn with me to 2 Chronicles chapter 24. Second Chronicles chapter 24. Joash was 7 years old. How old was he?
Seven.
Doesn't sound like he's grown to me unless the Bible is inaccurate. The Bible says Joash was 7 years old when he began to reign, and he reigned 40 years in Jerusalem. His mother's name was Zibiah of Beersheba. And Joash did that which was right in the eyes of the Lord all the days of Jehoiada the priest. Jehoiada got for him 2 wives, and he had sons and daughters. Now that's a problem. After this, Joash decided to restore the house of the Lord, and he gathered the priests and the Levites and said to them, go out to the cities of Judah and gather from all Israel money to repair the house of your God from year to year and see that you act quickly. But the Levites did not act quickly. So the king summoned Jehoiada the chief and said to him, why have you not inquired the Levites to bring in from Judah and Jerusalem the tax levied by Moses? And the servant of the Lord and the congregation of Israel for the tent of testimony. For the sons of Athaliah, that wicked woman, had broken into the house of God and had also used all the dedicated things of the house of the Lord for Baals. So the king commanded, and they made a chest and set it outside of the gate of the house of the Lord, and proclamation was made throughout Judah and Jerusalem to bring in for the Lord the tax that Moses, the servant of God, laid on Israel in the wilderness. And all the princes and all the people rejoiced and brought their tax and dropped it into the chest they had finished. And whenever the chest was brought to the king's officers by the Levites, they saw that there was much money in it. The king's secretary and the officer of the priest, chief priest, would come and empty the chest and take it and return it to its place. Thus they did day after day and collected money in it to those who had charge of the work of the house of the Lord, and they hired masons and carpenters to restore the house of the Lord, and also workers in iron and bronze to repair the house of the Lord. So those who were engaged in the work labored, and the repairing went forward in their hands, and they restored the house of God to its proper condition and strengthened it. I hope you don't mind reading the word on the Sabbath morning. Verse 14. And when they had finished, they brought the rest of the money before the king and Jehoiada, and with it were made utensils for the house of the Lord, for both the service for the burnt offering and the dishes for incense and vessel of gold. And they offered burnt offering in the house of the Lord regularly all the days of Jehoiada. But Jehoiada grew old and full of days and died. He was 130 years old at his death. And they buried him in the city of David among the kings because he had done good in Israel and towards God and his house. Now after the death of Jehoiada, the princes of Judah came and paid homage to the king. Then the king listened to them, and they abandoned the house of the Lord. Let me read that one more time. And they abandoned the house of the Lord, the God of their fathers, and served Asherim and the idols. And wrath came upon Judah and Jerusalem for this guilt of theirs. Yes, he sent prophets amongst them to bring them back to the Lord. These testified against them, but they would not pay attention. I'm almost finished. Then the Spirit of God clothed Zechariah, the son of Jehoiada, the priest, and he stood above the people and said to them, "Thus says God, why do you break the commandments of the Lord so that you cannot prosper? Because you have forsaken the Lord, he has forsaken you." But they conspired against him, and they commanded of the king. They stoned him with stones in the court of the house of the Lord. Thus Joash the king did not remember the kindness that Jehoiada Zechariah's father had shown him, but killed his son. And when he was dying, he said, "May the Lord see and avenge." It's interesting how the Bible often plays itself out. I know many of us are accustomed to keeping our dirty secrets, our dirty soul stories to ourselves, but I like the way that God is transparent with us in his word, because he wants us to see exactly the type of family that he belongs to, that he had no problem coming to save. Are you with me so far? There's a problem. The problem is the same as it has always been throughout Israel's history. God gives them leadership. Leadership begins to reform. Leadership changes. And the people go back. Now that problem is not just indicative of young kings, especially since Joash is 7. There are other kings that are older, more mature, and I wish I had more time, but I won't, but you can read for yourself in the Chronicles and the Kings, and look at the kings, you'll find that whether or not individuals are young or old, it doesn't change whether or not they will follow God and seek God. It's always a personal decision. Now this is important, young people, because today this is your message, but the principle will connect to the rest of us. It's this: whenever God calls you, he expects you to do that which is right, despite how old or young you may be. So why is Joash so important? I'm glad you asked, because maybe this is where I'll go right away. What's important about Joash is that he really should not be king. If you follow the context of his life, his father is killed, and they are about to kill his entire family, and somebody, Jehoshabeath, she is the daughter of the priest. She takes Joash, and she hides him for 6 years. Now, this is key, because here we are in the midst of church, in the midst of Sabbath school classes and adventures and pathfinders. The Bible records that even though there aren't any of those ministries there, there is somebody that sees in the youthfulness of Joash that while his family is at stake of being destroyed, somebody sees the potential in him and puts him aside, studying under the priest so that he will be equipped, even at the age of 7, to follow God. Say it a different way, Pastor Anderson. Often at times what I find when I listen to individuals, they will say, it's too soon for them to learn about who God is. They don't need Sabbath school. They don't need adventurers. They don't need pathfinders. They don't need AY. When they get older, we will train them and they will be fine. But the truth is, the longer you wait to impart the wisdom, the understanding, the commandments of God and his word, is the more likely you will find that our young people will not be equipped to serve the church faithfully. Yeah. Even the Catholic Church understands that if I can just get your child for the first informative years of their lives, if I can get them for the first 7 years, if I can put them in their school system,
by the time they become a grown-up, they will never leave the church because they understand their doctrines. And so what about us? We'll teach them French. We'll teach them how to play basketball. We'll take them to track and field. We'll take them to the movies, but we don't always take them under our wings and give them Jesus at a young age. Because the truth is that as they observe us, they know what's important. Work is important. We go to work every day. Work is important. Eating is important. Wi-Fi is important. Nice clothes and nice suits are important. They know that because we put our money and our time behind that. But what about the spiritual things that would allow them to move from waiting until 21 to serving the church at 7? See, I don't expect you to say amen, because I feel like I might be stepping on some corn toes today, but let it squeeze, let it squeeze, let it squeeze. Joash should not be king, because the truth is the evil Athaliah, who is the mother of his father, she does not want him to be king. As a matter of fact, when his father dies, rather than give it over to one of her children, she now steps in and sits on the throne, and that's a problem. What the problem is that God has already created a system by which, through the genealogy, there would never be a child that would not sit on the throne, and she usurps God's role so that she can have her way at the expense of even her own children. Oh, here's the question. Here's the question, Sister Hamden. Why would you usurp God for the purpose then of having your own way at the cost of your own child and the other children and the nation? It just doesn't make sense. And here's the truth, church, and I know it's going to be a quiet message today. The truth is that in this chapter, God is reminding us that we have to handle our children with care, because our children can be great even when they're young. First Timothy 4 and verse 12 says, let no one despise your youth, but be an example to the believers in word, in conduct, in love, in spirit, in faith, and in purity. The Bible also says in Ecclesiastes chapter 12 and verse 1, remember your Creator in the days of your youth, before the days of trouble come and the years approach when you will say, I find no pleasure in them. God says in His Word that age is not a criteria for greatness. The hindrance is often us who do not put the greatness in our children. You know, I hope you don't mind, Pastor Nichols, you said this publicly so I can say it. When I listen to you talking about your journey of being a pastor, I love to hear the fact that you said, from a young child, your father saw something in you. And when he looked at you, he may have been saying for years before he said it to you, he probably said, my son is going to become a pastor, but I'm not going to push him. But I will position him to make that decision at the appointed time. So what does your father do? He doesn't leave you at home with the Nintendo system and the Sega system. He doesn't leave you outside riding your bike with all of the children of the neighborhood, even though they have cross-cultural views to what he believes as the man of the house. What your father does is he makes sure that when he's preaching at crusades and he's going to church, he just invites you to come to hang out with daddy. But really what he's doing is he's discipling you by making you take the trip with him so that you can see what pastoring will be before you get there. Which means that long before Fred Nichols becomes Pastor Fred Nichols, he's already been pastoring even without a position. See, you don't get it yet. You're too quiet right now, because you have to understand this thing. Because Because really what I'm trying to tell you today is that greatness can start at 7, even if you don't sit on the throne until later on. One of the things that I would love to see happening more as I'm walking through the pews and listening to the conversation is I would love to hear more parents talking audibly to their children about what can you be and how do you get there and what's it going to take to get there. The challenge that I observe now is that you just expect your children to grow and become great, but it doesn't happen that way. Somebody's got to hide them for 6 years in the council of spiritual people so that when spiritual people are touching them and blessing them like Brother Shaw did to his children, there is something that is implanted in them that I am great now even though I'm not sitting on the throne yet. One of the reasons why our young people don't often see themselves where they need to be is because we don't tell them when they're young, you can be great. Let me tell you, maybe it's good, this may be a testimony Sabbath. I remember when I was just a child, my mom, even when I was wayward, and I'm wayward, let me just call it for what it is, I'm wayward. I'm looking at Sister Griffiths, I'm wayward. And when I was young, my mom, despite some of the choices that I would make with my life, there would be times where she would come in before she would go to work. And she would leave the house at 5:30, 6 o'clock in the morning to take the train all the way down to Mount Sinai Hospital. She would open the door, even in my confusion and my foolishness and my stubbornness, she would open the door and she would say to me, Andre, today is the day you can be what God has created you to be. Every single morning, so that even when I would make decisions that would be contradictory to that which she wanted me to be, I couldn't get her words out of my head. Because that's why we read the Word of God, because when the Word of God is in our head, despite the choices that we make for our own lives, despite what we may or may not be as parents, you can't get it out of your head when once it's in there. So Josiah, he's 7, it's true. He's young, it's true. But when he sits on the throne, because he has been counseled by the priest for no less than 6 years, right away he says to himself, let's repair, first of all, the temple of God. Seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and everything, all of these things shall be added unto you. Which means then, when we instill in our children at a young age that they can be great, but the kingdom of God precedes their career, when they build the kingdom of God first, they will be great in their careers. It doesn't happen the other way around. You don't just become a big shot on Young Street and downtown on Front Street, and then you give your heart to Christ. You give your heart to Christ first and watch him grow you in the midst of heathens. I make no apology for what I'm saying. Because when I come into the house of God and I see that sometimes our children might be a little bit nervous to do things in the presence of God's people, it means to some degree we have missed the mark, because they ought not to be nervous when they're serving in the capacity of doing something for God, when we train them and show them that God wants you to be great. Yes. How does it happen? When he sits on the throne, whoever has been training him and instilling things in his heart for those 6 years, what they're showing him is that when you finally sit on the throne, here's what you need to do first. Rebuild the temple first. Don't buy a brand new Nike first. Don't buy a 5-house garage first. Don't go out and spend all your money on suits and nice dresses and 3.5 heels that you carry.